This video is a code walkthrough for the example file StringUsage.java. So let's assume we've downloaded that, and we'll open it up in JGrasp and take a look. For starters, let's compile this file and free run it, and we'll see that it spews a bunch of stuff out. So let's go through this file a little more carefully and in detail. What this file does is it gives usage examples of most all the methods of the string class that we've discussed in prior video lectures. So in this first part, we have our declarations, and notice that we've declared a couple of string objects, but not instantiated them. Then in the second part, and we'll go ahead and set a breakpoint on main by clicking in the left margin, click on the debug icon, and we'll start single stepping our way through. And this part right here is where we're setting up several strings. Here's a string that we're setting up in the formal way using the new keyword and a string constructor and the text we want to initialize the string with. This next statement is the creation of an empty string as shown here. And this is how we would create a string in the more typical way by simply equating some body of text to some string object. Okay, so we've got three strings declared and instantiated. In this next section, we're exploring the length method of string. And remember that all the methods of any class are run in the context of some existing object. So when we run the length method here, we're finding the length of this string greeting, which is the 5-character string hello. So if we execute this, we should see a length of 5. And we'll just print that out to the screen. It's working as expected. Similarly, the length of an empty string should be 0. And the length of this longer string is, I'm not sure what it's going to be. It says 40. We could count that, but I'll assume that that's right. So going on here a little bit, let's take a look at the use of the charAt method. The charAt method, if you recall, returns the character at a specified string index. So this is the string we're going to operate on. And remember that the first character of any string is not at index 1, but at index 0. So this should give us the first character of this string, which is a capital H. And we'll just echo that out. Looks fine. So here we're trying to find the last character of a string. We could count the characters here, or rather the indices, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and know that the last character is at index 4, and we could find the last character that way. That would work, but that's really not the way we should do things. Instead, it's much preferable to do this in a more general way by using the length method of the string in tandem. So for example, here the length of the string is 5. We subtract 1 because strings are 0 based, and we get a 4, and we're going to get the same result, but this is a much more general way, and this will be true and valid for any string rather than this approach, which assumes that the string is always going to be of 5 characters. So always find the last character of a string in this manner. Alright, moving on then. Let's take a look at the indexOf method. And the indexOf method performs the converse operation. Given a certain character or string, it's going to tell us where in the string, at what index, that pattern is found. So if again our string greeting is hello, we should find this at the second place, or index 1. And we do. This one should be found at index 2. And notice here we're using the overloaded form of index of, which takes a second argument. Now we want to find the second occurrence, or rather the next occurrence of the character L. So we need to start looking for that string, excuse me, that character, not at the beginning of the string, but one character past where we know the first L is. So if we know that the first L is at this index, we'll start searching for the next one, one character past that, and that'll find it at the third character, as we expect. Now we're looking for a certain string within a string, And notice here we were looking for characters within single quotes. Now we're looking for a string search pattern within double quotes. So we're looking for the LO, which we should find at 0, 1, 2, 3. And we do. And in this one, we're looking for the string another within a different string, message. So we'll remind ourselves of what that was. And that was this long string here. We're looking for the location of this string within it. And we will find that at index 8. Is that the right answer? Let's see. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yes, that's the right place. Now we're looking for a different string, and we're not going to find this one. Notice that I've intentionally misspelled this with an additional n, so we're not going to find that, so it should return a minus 1, and it does, and that's the indication that we haven't found it. Next, let's use the substring method. So we're going to extract the substring between characters 0 and 2. And remember that there's a little subtlety here. It's going to extract up to the position 1 before this second index. So it's going to extract the substring from index 0 to index 2 minus 1, or 1. Or in other words, 2 characters. And we can return that to another string and print it out. What we're doing here is we're extracting a substring from a given index to the end of the string. And notice that this is okay. Normally there would be no character at index equal to length, because that would be one past the end of the string normally. But because of that subtlety, it's going to extract to the index position 1 before this, which in fact will be the end of the string. So this is going to extract from position 3 to the end of the string, giving us the LO, as seen here. Now here's a more general way of extracting a certain search string from a larger string. Here's the string we're looking for, and let's find where it's located using this call to index of. Then once we've done that, we can make an extraction from that known index point to this index, which is simply the beginning of the string advanced by the length of the string we're looking for, which is going to give us the substring we're after. And we can just print that out and show that we've got the right one and its length. Next, let's look at the case-changing methods. Here we're going to print out the original string, and notice that it hasn't changed even though we've applied the two uppercase to it, because remember that this entire method call returns a copy, and this is still the original string. Here, if we print it out as uppercase or lowercase, if we print it out, we'll see that it's still the same original string, because this hasn't made any kind of permanent change to the original string. This is just a copy, but the original is unaltered. If we want to permanently change the string, what we need to do is take that uppercase copy and write it back over itself, like so, so that when we print it out again, we'll see that it's an uppercase. Finally, here are some examples of string concatenation. Let's set up a new string, thing 1 and thing 2. And we'll glue them together and print them out. And we've got the intervening character in the middle. Here we've got a string literal with a numerical value. And you've probably seen this quite a bit by now. But this is what we would do if we want to print out the value of some variable. We can just simply print it out using string concatenation with some identifying label and the value of the variable. And here, we're setting up an original string, printing it out, and then we're going to append to that an additional string using this string concatenation shortcut operator. So we're going to tack on to the end of list we're going to add milk plus a comma, and we'll print it out like so. Then we're going to tack on bananas to the end and print it out. And finally, what we're doing here, here's a CS12 date object. This just happens to be my birthday. So we'll set that up. And here are two ways of printing out an object. Notice that we've got the same result each way, but here we're printing out the object using its toString method explicitly. Here we're doing it implicitly. What's happening here is a toString is getting appended to the end of this. So two ways of printing out the string representation of an object. And hopefully this will give you a number of examples of using the various string methods and displaying various quantities as part of larger strings using string concatenation.